This episode of Bourbon on Ice, presented by your friend Frosty and your bartender Mike Whiskey, is brought to you by the Cape Media Center of Cape Cod, Massachusetts. The views and opinions expressed during this podcast do not necessarily reflect those of the Cape Media Center. Listener discretion is advised.
So Frosty, what did you do this morning?
I spent the morning at the Wicked Waves Water Park. Remember when you and I went there?
I do remember.
Yeah, we were in the water so long the lifeguard changed ethnicity.
That was pretty fun.
We were pretty pruny.
Yeah.
We should do that again.
Yes, we should. Grab some more drinks.
But first,
we have an episode. Roll the music!
Welcome, listeners, to Bourbon on Ice,
where we talk about everything nerdy, like gentlemen.
Join us every week for our local Cape Cod take on, well, everything.
Laugh, cry, be confused, and laugh some more.
I'm your friend Frosty.
And I'm your bartender, Mike Whiskey.
Stay tuned! You think they'll like the episode?
Oh, they'll definitely love it.
Hello, everyone, and welcome to a very, 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 very hot episode of Bourbon on Ice.
It is. We got the muggies over here.
It's like 84 out.
86.
Is that
Which
why...
Which is 29 degrees Celsius.
Thank you, Dr. Science. Is that why this glass in my hand full of water seems to be, you know, not ice cold anymore? I swear I put ice into this thing 5 seconds ago.
Yeah, that would be why.
Then again, you know, it could be... negative 23 degrees, and we could be in our delivery truck screaming, crying, miserable.
I have the door open when it's that cold out.
Why? what kind of crazy... Oh, that's right, I forgot. You love nature. I am your friend Frosty.
And I'm your bartender, Mike Whiskey.
And this is that show where we discuss all things nerdy,
like gentlemen.
And today we have a special treat for you. Everyone gets an adorable puppy! Now.
We're not Oprah rich.
No, we don't have the cash for that, no.
No.
I don't know how we would get them to...
But if you check under your seats right now...
You'll find nothing!
You might find loose change.
We're responsible for that.
Yeah.
Our powers are vast and creepy.
Some might call it eldritch.
He might call it eldritch.
Or Lovecraftian.
Or Orwellian. No, wait, that's me. Yeah, that's a whole bunch of nerdy references. We're gonna let you all pause the episode and go to Google and look those up.
No, those are pretty well-known references, though.
Also, I've been personally informed by several people that they don't want us to talk about Pokemon anymore, so... Kabutu, Persian, Paris... No, wait, I'm not gonna do a poker rap.
No, don't.
I totally
Please
could.
Please don't. No. I'm gonna put a stop to that.
Primate,
you can all thank me later. The tape is going over his mouth now.
But then that'll be in a boring episode. For what is Bourbon on Ice without Frosty goodness? Our new tagline. Oh my gosh! I just freaking stumbled into that. Okay, so everyone,
I can't with you. I can't with you.
He can't. He tried, but he can't. So, on January 26th of 2022, an episode dropped onto the internet, and it was called Episode 1. They're back, and they have coloring books.
Yeah, our first episode.
It was us.
It was.
It was us, sorry.
And that was the beginning of our wonderful journey with you.
Thank you so much for listening, but we have noticed that, you know, things have changed a bit since then.
Just a little bit.
So we're going to do what I've noticed other shows every once in a while do. Like, hey, you want to talk about that old episode we did? They call this, you know, a throwback or a flashback or a rewind. I guess it's a flashback for us.
Okay.
Let's call it a flashback. I don't know what that was.
I don't know if we should call it flashback because we have an episode coming up about flashback. Or that we already did.
Hang on, let me pull that back in. Successfully pulled in. No one remembers it. That's how this works, right?
That is a strong sphincter.
Oh. I can't with you.
I get my revenge.
Yes, that's what he does. So before we get into that, I believe we have another order of business.
Yes, we do.
Whiskey.
Before we go too far into our... rewind, throwback, we have our answer to Whiskey Asks.
And I just gotta say, you people never let us down.
No, you don't.
I mean, if you take out the awful, horrible, controversial responses to what merchandise should we sell and you're recommending, you know, marital aids.
Well, at least we can say you did not disappoint us.
You kept us entertained.
So we are going to start off our list today with Frosty's pick.
Me? I'm so honored!
Oh, no, you're not. You wrote the script.
I did make sure to put mine at the very top of the list. I didn't want anyone missing it.
Who put down Inception and The Lion King?
Both. Wait, you gotta remind everyone what the question was.
Oh, yes, the question, which was, what is your favorite film score?
And I had to do some soul searching.
You really did. It took you until just a few minutes before the show started to actually, like, nail down what you wanted.
No, I was able to nail it, but it's been ever since that day I've been, like, going back. Is that really the... No.
Second-guessing yourself.
Is it? Yeah.
Like the multiple-choice question on a quiz.
Yes, very much. Very much so.
But Frosty picked Inception and The Lion King, which were both composed by Hans Zimmer.
Yes, I know I was supposed to choose one, but, like, that's like the one film score, and I don't mean just the opening number, I mean like the actual film score that has stayed with me all my life. I can sing it, I can hum it, I hear it. You hear it in the video games, you hear it when you go to the parks in certain areas, and you say, oh, that's from The Lion King. But as for Hans Zimmer's Inception, there is a great deal of music that it just gut punches you with epicness. Knock, knock, who's that? It's epicness. Bam! You've been gut-punched.
I'm gonna punch your face. In the face.
that's a loaded reference. Hey, Whiskey, do you have one?
I do have one. It was difficult for me to choose, but I think I shall go a little bit of an unexpected route and say the Gladiator soundtrack.
Really?
Yeah. I love Lord of the Rings, but... and Star Wars... And those are definitely up there, along with Indiana Jones, Howard Shore, and John Williams.
Everybody loves John Williams.
Everybody loves John Williams.
Even if you say you don't, or you say you haven't heard something by him, you have, you just don't know it yet.
But there's something ethereal and epic that never quite leaves my mind about the Elysium from Gladiator.
Oh, you're right.
Yeah. Boom. Or Elysium, and what was the other one? Wow. Honor Him.
Whoa, no, it's just, this is the first time I've thought about that soundtrack in years, and...
Yeah, wow. It comes right back to you.
It is.
Anyways, enough about us. Roseanne from Barnstable answers Staying Alive.
Staying alive.
That's enough.
But...
Do you want to get copyrighted? Copyright strike? Stop it. Robbie from Yarmouth says, answers Jaws. And that is a very good choice. Bo from Plymouth answered, Spirited Away has some great music scoring. And yes, it does. Everything by Studio Ghibli is wonderful and amazing and is much loved. Howl's Moving Castle.
I was on a job interview and the woman who was interviewing me had some music playing in the background. I interrupted her saying, wait a second, is that the suite from Spirited Away? She looked at me and said, you know that movie? And we just bonded over that and I got the job. I was fired a month later.
Nepotism at its finest. Karen from Baltimore answers the original La Cage au Folle, Ennio Morricone. I could listen for hours and hours and something new would appear musically. Don't you just love when you can get such wonderful depth from your music? You listen to it once and you hear all the bass, and then you can listen again and get all the percussions.
I feel guilty. I've never actually seen La Cage au Folle.
I haven't either, but that shouldn't surprise you or anyone else listening to this podcast.
We are shocked. Shocked, I tell you. This is our shocked face.
This reminds me of something we'll bring up when we get to... our throwback of the
episode.
Ivan from Buffalo, New York answers Interstellar, also by Hans Zimmer.
Yay, Hans.
Hans is great. Bob from Plymouth answers the soundtrack from Thelma and Louise.
Huh.
Jacob asked, Knast, or Nast.
Nast.
Nast. Answers Blade Runner, Vangelis, and Happy Together, Danny Chung.
Those are some good choices, actually.
Yeah. Todd from Florida answers The Empire Strikes Back by John Williams. Yes.
I predicted there'd be at least one Star Wars.
As did I. And I'm not disappointed. Jared Eaton from Florida says it's a toss-up between Jerry Goldsmith's Supergirl or Hans Zimmer's Backdraft and Sleeping with the Enemy.
Another Hans Zimmer.
Oh, yes. I'm sensing a theme in this one. H.D. Harry Minen answers, I'm a big fan of music from John Williams. There we go, another Star Wars and Indiana Jones guy, among other things.
I could cry happy tears.
DM James Fairbanks in Brooklyn, New York, answers Gone with the Wind and Anything by Bernard Herrmann. Gone with the Wind.
Gone with the Wind. That is iconic.
That is iconic. Shane from Kentucky answers The Good, the Bad, and the Ugly by Ennio Morricone. It's iconic. Yes, it is. Ecstasy of Gold. Wa-da-da-da-da! Wah-wah-wah!
I can't believe you pulled that up perfectly.
Not quite perfectly, but close enough to be good. Michael from Minneapolis answers Gone with the Wind.
Gone with the wind, gone with the wind. The wind is going, the wind is gone. Those are the words.
Is it just me, or are we getting a lot more diversity in terms of our listenership?
Honestly, I thought we were just going to have, you know, like all Star Wars, but this is surprising me.
No, I meant in the places that people are from, we're getting listeners from a lot more places now. Not just the people we know.
And we thank all of you.
Yes, we do.
Let Bourbon on Ice blanket the world.
We appreciate the fact that you appreciate our nonsense.
What you said sounded better.
Let's see, where was I? Colt from Colorado answers Dr. Zhivago and 2001 A Space Odyssey.
I'm afraid I can't do that, Dave.
I'm glad you made the joke so that I didn't. Myra from Provincetown answers Disney's Fantasia, which is a great pick.
So much music in it.
There is. That's why it's a great pick. It's almost like a purely musical experience. Very excellent choice, Myra. Billy out of San Francisco answers Lawrence of Arabia. I love that movie. You made a very good pick. Are we talking the original or the newer one?
There's a newer one?
Is there a newer one? You were telling me the other day there was a newer one.
No, I was making fun of that ridiculous hat you were wearing and saying you look like Lawrence of Arabia.
Yeah. And then I said, yeah, I love that movie. And then you're... No.
We were at a water park.
True. Marcelo Reyes from Sao Paulo, Brazil.
Yay, Brazil!
Rock on. Says the Blade Runner Vangelis. Another one.
Vangelis does some outstanding work, but you have to admit that Blade Runner is what he is mostly known for.
That's true. John from Illinois answers Lion King, like Frosty, Last of the Mohicans, like Elder Nerd, and Chariots of Fire.
Dun, 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 dun. Running in slow motion. Dun, 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 dun. Still running in slow motion.
You know what was hysterical?
Oh, that moment when the person you hate fell down the stairs and landed in a pool of their own blood.
No, I have very fond memories of playing that song on Wii Music on the Wii.
Putting my drink down. Moving on.
Robert says The Wiz and Rocky Horror Picture Show. Not surprised. Not at all.
Sarcastic clap.
You have outdone yourself, Robert. Drew from Palm Springs answers...
Did you say Palm Springs?
Palm Springs.
You just said Palm Springs.
No, I didn't.
That's a wonderful place. Is it related to the place with the trees?
I didn't. Into the Wild, Eddie Vedder's crooning tears me up. Aww. Douglas from Austin, Texas answers The Hours.
Ooh, there's a tearjerker for you.
Michael Bernier from Mass says The Hours and The Wiz. All right.
More Hours, more Wiz.
Yeah. Corey from New Jersey answers Dr. Horrible's sing-along blog.
A man's gotta do what a man's gotta do.
Harrison Lee from the UK. The film I would watch again and again is Singing in the Rain.
There's the Broadway. You were saying, is there going to be any Broadway? There's the Broadway.
There it is.
That technically counts as Broadway.
Circus Kirkus.
Our dearest friend.
Yes. Yeah. Answers Ben-Hur, which is an excellent choice.
Who's Ben-Hur? Anyone who wanted to. But I'll leave now.
Thank you. And Saturday Night Vigor. Scott B.
Fever.
Vigor.
No, it's Saturday Night Fever.
You wrote Vigor.
Oops.
Saturday Night Fever. We're keeping that in.
We're keeping that.
Scott Beach from Syracuse answers Chariot of Fire by John Williams. Excellent. Oh, and John Williams. Excellent choices. Oliver Carter from Maymeow, Central Myanmar. Okay. Titanic, all caps. Excellent choice.
He feels passionately about that. And also, we have a listener in Myanmar. That's awesome.
That is awesome. Thank you for listening. Bill in Holland, Michigan answers The Lion King makes me all weepy because it was the first animated movie that my late boyfriend and I did not get to go see together.
Aww.
And Inception is absolutely breathtaking. The same too as yours.
I feel moved.
Yeah.
And seen.
And seen. And understood.
And appreciated. And loved. Someone should. So, is that it?
That is all. And I want to thank everyone again for taking the time to answer. We really do love hearing your answers. And it gives me and Frosty the incentive to go look these things up if we have never heard them and listen to them and experience them ourselves as
Oh wait, are you, Whiskey, saying that you're going to get out from under your rock and actually watch a movie?
No, I just listen to what they...
Small victories here, people. Small victories. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. We'll have another one of these. The next time, the question will be something salacious and dirty. Or not.
Or not.
Okay, then. People, check out now.
It'll be pretty fun, though.
Always.
Stay tuned for the end of the episode, because I'll have my next question.
You've already got another one.
I've already got another one.
Duck, people. Just duck.
I'm getting better with this.
Okay, now that that is over, now we can get to what's actually important. Now that was actually pretty good, but now we can get to something that we promised. Yeah, promised. That's a better word. So, over a year ago, the two of us decided to sit down at the Cape Media Center in their recording room and started a terrible episode. Like, it was not good.
It was bad. The music overplayed our voices a lot.
You know how I tend to speak a lot and he not as much?
That was
more.
That was very prominent. I was an awkward little duckling.
It was like 95% The Frosty Show with special guest Milk Toast Whiskey.
Yeah.
We scrapped it and we started over and we came up with a new episode. But you got to remember, people, we were still learning things. We were still, you know, trying to figure out how this works.
Yeah. We actually made a note of when we cut the break.
We didn't have
We don't do that so much anymore.
We didn't have our pre-recorded intro. We would do every intro live.
Yep.
We would end every episode with, and here's what's coming next episode.
Yeah, we did. All except for the first one. We didn't do that the first one.
There was less sound effects. I noticed that too.
Fewer sound effects, but the ones that did play and the music that played,
yeah,
really drowned us out.
There are two types of people when it comes to listening to podcasts. And I mean non-episodic podcasts. You've got the people who will listen to the most recent episode that has come out, or the ones who will go all the way back to the first episode these people have ever dropped. And I can see benefits to both. You know, I want to get the feeling of who these people are, so I'll go to their beginning. That can be bad, because like us, you know, they could still be kicking the tires, figuring out how things work, and the product could be totally different. But then you've got the people who don't take the time to learn the podcaster's ways and jump in, you know.
And foibles.
Yeah, and they jump in at the end, like, who are these guys? They talk as though they've been doing this forever, which they probably have. And there are people out there with hundreds, and this is like our, what, 67th?
There are some people with thousands.
We are up to 60. This is episode 67. Thank you for coming along.
Oh, yes.
We're Phineas and Ferbing it here.
Join in two episodes for a very fun episode.
Oh, my God.
A very nice episode.
But that's my point right there. It's like, I'm so worried that we've had listeners who have jumped in on episode one and gone, huh, that wasn't the best. I'm not going to listen anymore. To which I agree, yeah, it was not our best. We were still learning.
No. And I was awkward and, like, not all there.
I was quieter.
Yeah.
Which is a feat.
It is a feat.
In itself, it's a feat.
It's almost as if you were afraid of the microphone at the media station.
Honestly, I think I know what it was. I think it was the fact that I was so used to being on the radio, doing every single show live, that I couldn't get comfortable with the fact that this was not live. This was going to go to editing.
Mm.
So I was picking everything so freaking carefully. It was almost very clinical. And there was a lot more research. I mean, we always do our research, but we, you know, came in with some scientific stuff and whatnot. I think it was funny what we did. It's just, we've done better episodes since then.
Oh, much better episodes.
The arrival of the 6-foot-tall TARDIS man.
And for some reason as well, my episodes with the Philippine escapades were very popular.
Those are very popular. I will notice that we have, since we've diversified and you can find us everywhere on every single channel now, our download numbers are starting to vary because people are streaming us. And we're not letting that bother us. But we will ask, you know, please continue to download, rate, review, like, share.
Comment.
Tell a friend, because that's how we get there. Leave ratings. Send us things. I'm a size L t-shirt.
Please don't send me anything. Your support online is enough for me.
Whatever you want to send him, send me instead. I will hawk that stuff.
He has no shame.
None. Oh, no shame.
No shame? The no shame dance?
I'm dancing to no shame, yeah. Dancing with no shame, yeah.
That's probably copyrighted too.
You think?
Those almost blue screws.
Okay, so I'm just going to push this button right here, and we are going to play a bit of that first episode, and I hope you don't judge us too harshly, people. Sorry. I can't do it. You want to push the button?
I push all the buttons around here.
Hysterical.
The Cape Media Center, located in Dennisport, Cape Cod, Massachusetts, is a non-profit community media center and the public access TV station for the towns of Barnstable, Yarmouth, Dennis, Harwich, and Chatham. Our mission is to build community through media, enhance democratic communication, and facilitate free expression by providing these towns with a state-of-the-art media resource center. Members can become trained in our video and audio equipment and produce their own media content. Membership includes training classes, access to our field equipment, studios, and facility, as well as airtime. Podcasters and music producers can share their content on our website. For more information, visit capemedia.org.
This episode of Bourbon on Ice is brought to you by Market Street Bookshop in Mashpee Commons, located at 31 Market Street, Mashpee, Massachusetts. Embrace diversity and find support for local authors and artists at the Market Street Bookshop, where your favorite new read is just a browse away. For more information, give them a call at 508-539-6985. Coming up on this episode of Bourbon on Ice.
Your favorite Cape Cod DJs return to the airwaves.
Well, sort of. We help you get to know us and love us all over again.
And we talk about something trendy, something important. Coloring books.
This is Bourbon on Ice with your friend Frosty.
And your bartender, Mike Whiskey.
Stay tuned. Hello there, this is your friend Frosty.
And your bartender Mike Whiskey.
And you're listening to Bourbon on Ice. I think we've made that point clear.
Maybe. We could say it one more time, because it's a cool name.
Should we do it together?
Sure, let's try it.
Okay, 1, 2, 3.
Bourbon on Ice.
And I'm thirsty now.
I got some juice boxes.
Are we subliminizing people out there?
Or what?
Oh my gosh, do we have powers that we're not aware of?
I don't know. I wouldn't know. I'm not aware of them.
Ooh. Okay, well, anyway, I think we should just jump right into this and say, hi, everyone. We're back. For those of you who know who we are, it's us again. And for those of you who don't, let me introduce myself. I am your friend Frosty.
Yeah, I think the people who know about us are few and far between. But I am your bartender, Mike Whiskey.
Are they really far in between? We should probably do something about that.
If we had some fans who listened to us while they were driving home from the radio, from on their way to and from work and stuff while we were on the radio, hello. But I'm surprised you found us here, too.
That may happy, be how you know us, actually.
Happy we found you here, but...
We are two former radio DJs from 90.7 WKKL, and we have been Cape Cod radio DJs for quite some time, but then we stopped, and then we started up again.
Yeah, we went our separate ways and did a few things and a few other things that we're not going to tell you about.
No, because, you know, FCC and censors and the FBI looking for us and all that.
And lawyers, you know, they just tell us not to say these things.
Hidden identities, bodies to bury.
The witness protection program.
So many secrets.
Oh, yes.
You know what? We should
and
probably...
If we told you, we'd have to kill you.
Let's not do that. I mean, we do need a fan base, but we should tell them a little bit about ourselves. How about...
Yes, we should.
How about, like, three things, each of us,
all
so
right.
We can reintroduce ourselves.
All right, you go first, and then I'll go, and then you go, and then I go, and then they go.
How will we know if they're saying anything?
We'll check the comments section.
We have a comment section?
We will.
I like it. Okay, let's see, three things. Number one, this is your friend Frosty, and I'd like to say that one thing you should know about me is that I am diabetic. I was diagnosed last year, stage 2, and it turned my life upside down, and I was even hospitalized briefly, but, you know, I'm working through it, and I'm learning more about myself and how to keep myself healthy and all that, and that's something you should know about me.
Yeah, we're keeping you together, and... Learning all that dietary stuff. A few tips from me, because I got some gluten-free stuff going on. That helps with the diabetes a lot, actually.
Okay, your turn.
My turn? Oh, no. First thing you should probably know about me is I'm a simple guy. I'm not the brightest bulb on the tree, at least I'm lit. But I do love learning. You'll find me with books and all sorts of different things just coming up out of the top of my head.
But not figuratively. I mean, not literally, just figuratively, because that would be terrifying.
It would be terrifying.
Okay, then.
Yeah, just the metaphorical kind.
Stuff coming out of the top of your head. Have you ever seen the
That's
Puppet
called
Masters?
Hairs.
No, have you ever seen the Puppet Masters?
No.
Oh, it was a really freaky sci-fi film. Lots of aliens jamming themselves in the back of people's heads to
Ooh.
Take over them. Lots of blood.
What was that one? The Body Snatchers? That sounds like that.
You mean the original and not the invasion?
Yeah, the original.
Okay, good. The original was the good one. Creepy,
yeah.
But good.
Yeah.
Okay, my turn. Something you should know about me, number two, is I am a gay man. I am a gay leather man, as a matter of fact. Former title holder and very proud of it, involved in the community. I've got to make a big shout out to all my friends out there listening from all over. Hey, guys, representing here. Ooh. Miss you all, and butt smacks and whip cracks.
Oh, my goodness.
Yeah, I said that.
Yeah, I'm going to have to deal with it. You just handed it off to me, and now it's all red and sore.
Yeah, follow that. Your turn.
Wow, I don't know how I follow that. I follow that with, basically, I'm a Christian. I'm about as far away from that as possible. I'm a Christian. You look fabulous, though.
Thank you.
I know. No, I'm Christian. I'm pretty milk toast about it too. But I also, like I said, I love learning. I do a lot of reading. I've read the Tao Te Ching and started reading the Hindu scriptures. I'm sorry, I'm not gonna even attempt to try and pronounce that on air because I don't have any sort of dialogue thing here for me prepared. But also, I'm working my way through others because. Like learning about other people's religions too, even though I'm Christian. And
well, being Christian doesn't mean you can't learn about other things.
Well, yeah, that's something that people tend to forget about sometimes.
Sometimes some of the most fascinating things I've ever read happen to be from other cultures, languages, stories. One of my best friends actually gave me a book, Tales of the Unusual and Strange, or something like that. I gotta look it up. It's sitting on my nightstand, and it's all of these amazing stories from the Far East that were gathered and put back together over the years.
The Far East is definitely my favorite area for the older stories. They've got some great ones.
And notice how old these stories are. I'm calling it the Far East. That's how they're referenced in the book.
Yeah.
And not by country names at this point, by countries that don't even exist anymore. Okay. And the third thing you should know about me, most important, I am a nerd. Yes, me. I am a video gamer. I am a pinball player, a trading card game player. I have no interest whatsoever in sports unless that is basketball. Seriously, sorry. And
only basketball?
Only basketball. I love basketball. But, you know,
I'm kind of a hockey guy myself.
Hockey's fun if you're there watching it.
Yeah, it's definitely a spectator sport, especially when they start to fight. My favorite part.
Horror movies, video games. I write fanfic. I have a long love history with indie music, indie games, following indie artists. I am a 100% confessed nerd. Deal with it.
And, yeah, I'm a nerd, too. Yeah, crazy, I know. I'm a dungeon master. I played tabletop RPGs. Like Frosty, I do the trading card games and other video games. Pokemon, Legend of Zelda, it's all there. It's all in the game. It's all in the back catalog.
I just gotta say, I'm in the King community. He's in the gaming community. There's a distinction between dungeon master in those two contexts.
Don't get them confused.
Don't get them confused. You'll show up wearing the wrong thing to the wrong party.
I did that once. It wasn't pretty. Oh, we ended up having a great time, but it wasn't pretty to start.
Oh my gosh, there's got to be pictures of this. All right.
Not that you'll ever find.
You'd be surprised.
No. You wouldn't find these ones.
I will tell you that, you know, some of the most interesting parties, I'm going to put that in quotations, that I've been to, people get stopped at the door and they say, we're going to have to take cameras, frisk you for cell phones. And, you know, that just excites me. Like, oh, I'm going into a place where we can't record anything. What's going to happen in here? And then usually it's just all of us sitting around talking. Okay, so we did all of that. I'm bored now. Let's sit and talk. Which we should do now. Let's talk.
What are we talking about?
We are talking about a craze that has swept the world, and much like mason jars, food trucks, and TikTok, it was something that no one thought would catch on, that people thought would be just in and out, that people probably gave up years ago. Something dramatic. Something outstanding. It's coloring books.
Coloring books, woo-woo!
Yeah, I couldn't do any more build-up, I'm sorry. I just had to be blunt.
Yeah, there's only so much billowing and build-up.
Build-upping? Building up?
Yeah.
I thought you were trying to make up a word, like, from Dr. Seuss, embiggering and biggering.
No, not quite. I'm not that smart.
Coloring books, such an interesting concept. Something that years ago, as children, we were handed and told, here, do this and stay out of our hair for a while. Usually because mommy had a drink in her hand or daddy was, you know, running off in the opposite direction of us.
Out to get those cigarettes.
Colorful pencils, nice markers, and you could have a happy sun and people having a picnic.
And he never came back.
We're just going to leave that there. I'm just going to leave that there. Coloring books started making a comeback, and inexplicably, they grew beyond just the average designs of, you know, happy little farmland animals. Or
Mandelas.
Now they have become a therapeutic tool. Therapists recommend them. People everywhere hand them out. You know what? This seems like something that a pair of nerds should talk about.
Yeah.
I think it's time for the Cape Cod Nerd Word. I'm going to play the music.
Play.
I like this.
Yes.
I like this. Do you have any coloring books of your own?
I picked up one. Talk about on this segment, because I'd never done this before.
Really?
Yeah.
In all these years, you've never had one of your own?
Never had a coloring book of my own.
They're everywhere. There's superhero designs, there's horror designs, there's all this crazy stuff.
No.
You've never been tempted, like, in the store, just, like, seeing them?
Never tempted. The one I picked out, and it was sort of just on the spur of the moment, is fairy fashion. Fantasy fairy, so like in not Lord of the Rings, but like other fantasy novels.
Oh, you have it with you? Okay, let's see.
Yeah,
let's
I got it with. So, I just did the first one on the page, just a tree with the fairy and the swans.
That's beautiful. And how did it make you feel?
Made me felt bored.
The idea of coloring books is one that consumes time. It doesn't expend a lot of energy, and it also, to be blunt, doesn't expend a lot of brain power.
No, that's, yeah. There's nothing, brain was operating on, like, potato.
There's absolutely nothing wrong with a nice, you know,
calm, trite task. Go ahead and just kill a couple of minutes coloring things in. No one says there's even any rules that you have to have colors specifically done in the right way. I mean, let's not forget, what did they call it, paint by numbers?
Yeah, paint by numbers. That was big in the 80s and 70s.
Was that primarily a children's thing?
No, it was adults who did that.
Really?
Yeah. Yeah, they'd give you a box of watercolors or acrylic paint, and each one would be numbered 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, usually not too far beyond 10. And you'd paint in by the number, so your yellow would be 1, and everything 1 would be painted yellow.
Did you ever do these yourself?
I never did those, but it's talked about in Jackson Browne's song, The Pretender. He talks about, one of the lyrics is, we'll fill in the missing colors of our paint-by-number dreams.
That's deep.
That is deep.
Jackson Browne, is he a favorite of yours?
He is. Not the biggest favorite, but I do enjoy his music. It's meaningful.
You say colors, and the one that comes to my mind is actually one of the number one albums, The Day I Was Born, which is, of course, Cyndi Lauper singing True Colors.
Oh, yeah.
I got to grow up with such an awesome song. And it's been covered by so many people. And it has nothing to do with painting. It has nothing to do with drawing or painting. It's just show your true colors, which I think is a very important message.
It is an important message. But you know who also has a song about coloring?
Let's hear it.
It's Barbara Streisand, believe it or not. It was a financial flop. She sang a cover of the song My Coloring Book, which is perfect for this segment.
I've literally never heard of this song. I'm a gay person.
It was a financial flop, that Barbara Streisand song, but it was actually written by Fred Ebb and John Kander.
I'm a gay person, and I have never heard of this Barbara Streisand song?
Yeah.
I need to go, like, check in with a local gay group. I am, like, sit down, have a cup of coffee with them, and say, guys, there's an issue. We really need to discuss this.
Well, that's your prerogative. Yeah, that was 1962.
1962.
Yeah.
All right, I actually have something here that I should tell you about. I was trailing around on the internet looking for porn, but I also found information, you know, good information.
Oh.
According to, I actually stuck my nose into NPR looking around for information on coloring books, and I happened to come up with some interesting stuff from Steve Drummond over on NPR.
Oh, cool.
It was called The People vs. Coloring Books, The Verdict is In.
And what is the verdict?
He doesn't like them.
Nah, I can, don't get me wrong, I understand the appeal, but it's not for whiskey. In fact, in the research that I was doing, if you did coloring books as a kid, you are far more likely to enjoy coloring as an adult.
You didn't do them a lot as a kid, did you?
No, I didn't.
Steve Drummond was, as I bluntly said, against coloring books, claiming they celebrate conformity and they stifle creativity. He compared research on this article from Victor Lowenfeld, a 1947 professor at Penn State, the lack of creativity coloring books encourage, and also dependency upon someone else's outline of an object makes children much less confident in their own means of expression. They obviously cannot draw a cow as good as the one in the coloring book. Okay, I can understand that. I mean, I never tried.
I understand where you're coming from. I just don't agree with you.
Why would you bother trying? I mean, no one says you have to.
Yeah, and have you ever seen a child fill in the lines? No. I get a cow who's colored yellow.
A yellow cow.
A yellow cow.
That would make some interesting leather.
Yeah, it would. Very nice. Just broad strokes up and down. They colored in the cow. They colored in the sky. They colored in the grass, all yellow.
Oh, my gosh. It's like the lines don't exist. Yay, score. I like this kid.
Yeah, but you know, that's an interesting point, though, because it is an interesting point on Mr. Bannon?
Drummond's
point, because in the 60s, when My Coloring Book was written and performed by various artists, the coloring books that were out then were scathing political commentary. Not political commentary, social commentary. They'd give you a
6 1/2 dozen of the other.
Yeah, have you seen the pictures of these? They
Ooh, let me look. Pretty.
Yeah, that one is, this is my pill. It is pink. It keeps me sane. And that was the instructions. You were supposed to color in the pill pink. That's it. This is my suit. It is gray. If it is not gray, I will be fired. Color my suit gray.
This is a very depressing song. Tell me more.
That's not the song.
That's not the song?
Those were the instructions in the coloring books in the 60s.
You are kidding me.
No.
So, okay, that actually supports a little bit more of what I'm seeing here.
Yeah.
It's saying that it encouraged conformity and stifled creativity because there were specific instructions concerning what to color. And if you were, you know, going outside the lines, coming up with your own color, then the book was considered, quote, ruined. As in, a child would not be able to hand in. As though you're grading these. You bring it to your mother and father and say, here, I drawed you a horsey. And you're supposed to take it and say, well, this horsey looks very strange. It is blue, and you didn't color inside the lines. It's a failure. 20 lashes with a hickory switch. Okay, I'm sorry. There's a fairy riding a sad frog in this book, and it's kind of making me smile.
Yeah. I like that one. I almost colored that one in.
Why is the fairy riding a sad-looking frog?
Well, I didn't think the frog was looking sad. I thought frog was just being frog, but I don't know. Could be fun.
Not for the frog.
Oh, no. Not, of course not for the frog, but for the fairy, it'd be fun.
The fairy riding the sad frog. Oh, my gosh. That's a children's book. We should start that.
I don't know. I don't think it's so.
We won't know until we try. And you know why? Because creativity. And not giving in to conformity.
That's a huge leap you just made in that logic there.
I know, it just came to me.
Yeah, you shouldn't have.
We'll be right back.
The Cape Media Center, located in Dennisport, Cape Cod, Massachusetts, is a non-profit community media center and the public access TV station for the towns of Barnstable, Yarmouth, Dennis, Harwich, and Chatham. Our mission is to build community through media, enhance democratic communication, and facilitate free expression by providing these towns with a state-of-the-art media resource center. Members can become trained in our video and audio equipment and produce their own media content. Membership includes training classes, access to our field equipment, studios, and facility, as well as airtime. Podcasters and music producers can share their content on our website. For more information, visit capemedia.org.
Welcome back to Bourbon on Ice with your friend Frosty.
And your bartender, Mike Whiskey.
And we are talking about nerdy stuff.
Well, normie nerdy.
Normie nerdy.
Yeah. We're not getting too deep in the weeds here yet.
Is there a gauge for us about, if this is normie nerdy, what's uber nerdy?
When we start going into Metroid, the Metroid iceberg deep lore, Kirby, and the stuff that people don't know about.
I take it back. There is such a thing as uber nerdy.
Oh, yeah.
I did not see that coming.
You did? No, you didn't.
Me, I thrive off of bad 1980s trivia and bad movies. The 1980s are still where I live. I will probably, you know, one day die, and my heaven will be like a really bad 1980s retro pastiche.
I'm somewhere in the mid-90s.
One time, I'm not going to lie, there may have been a little glug, glug, glug involved in this. I actually had what I thought was a vision of what the afterlife looked like, and all I could say is, oh my gosh, it's an early DOS 1990s point-and-click adventure. Everything's pixelated.
Those were fun, though.
Those were amazing.
Yeah.
And I'm sitting here, like, there's an abundance of greens and yellow.
There's still point-and-click adventures on Newgrounds.com, man.
I love it when people make those and they become mainstream. Like, there's ones that get so big that they go onto Steam or something like that. I just love watching people rediscover what I knew in my youth.
Right.
Anyway, we were talking about coloring books, adult coloring books. Blunt and simple, these made a comeback, and then the pandemic did hit, and people were looking for things to do at home.
It made a second comeback.
It did. However,
not that I think it ever really went away. I mean, we talked about earlier, they were popular in the 60s. Paint by number was popular in the 80s and 90s, and coloring books made the return.
They're still here.
Yeah.
They're still here because there are people who just... I've seen people on vacation. I used to work in some really nice hotels out here on Cape Cod. Hey, we're on Cape Cod, just to remind everyone.
Yeah, they're nice hotels.
Why is it that I always wave my arms? You can't see me, but I've done this like 3 times tonight. Now I'm doing it a 4th time.
I think you're just trying to project the energy onto our audience.
That's not how podcasting works.
That's not how it works at all.
That's how Reiki works, and I don't do that.
No, but my aunt does.
I know several Reiki masters. I should really ask them about this.
Yeah.
Okay, so I used to work in a hotel, and I would just see the people in the chaise lounge chairs just taking out coloring books and sitting down by the beach and drawing things. And the thing is, over the years, I started noticing that they're not just, you know, happy landscapes and pretty design. Not that there can't be. There are some weird ones out there. Okay, we'll call it interesting with an asterisk on the end.
I think we should call these naughty.
We can call them naughty.
Yeah. Well, naughty, not nice.
Let me tell you some of the weird before the naughty. I was looking around and actually found some of these also online because I'd seen them in real life. There are brands of horror coloring books.
Horror?
Horror. Let me enlighten you to a couple of these.
All right. Enlighten me, yeah.
The ones I found online. The zombie coloring book.
Zombies. That's not a big surprise.
Rotting flesh.
Walking Dead brought that right back.
The Tim Burton coloring book.
That's not a big surprise either. Tim Burton's been popular forever.
Seriously, what on earth do you use for colors? I think of Tim Burton and suddenly I think of black and white stripes.
Well, you're definitely not using pastels.
Oh my gosh. Unless it's red. This is a good one. The horror coloring book, Scary and Creepy Chibi, Halloween Adult and Kids Coloring Pages.
One of these words is not like the other.
I'm gonna describe the cover that I'm looking at right now. There is an adorable child, Freddy Krueger, making a chain of headless paper dolls. Next to him is Michael Myers impaling a smiling pumpkin. And then there's Jason Voorhees giving Chucky the doll a piggyback ride. And there's just a healthy smattering of blood all over these people.
One of these things is not like the other. One of these things just doesn't belong.
This is not for children. This is an adult coloring book. I will say that. Who opens up their Christmas packages on Christmas morning and says, "Oh, good. Mom, I think I opened yours by mistake. Oh, good, that's mine."
I'm not sure that would be Mom opening that one. That might be Dad.
I don't think you've met my mother.
Oh, that's you're right. I have not met your mother.
And this is actually one of my favorites that I found. Abnormality 2. 2, indicating that this was a series. Abnormality 2, Haunting Visions. And right here on the cover is a zombie bride and zombie groom kissing. Their organs leaking everywhere, and because they're kissing, their tongues are falling out of each other's mouths, suspended on lines of entrails. So I guess you'll be using a lot of red for this coloring book.
red, purples, pinks.
A little brown for some bile?
Yeah.
Or is that gray?
Some might say yellowish.
Oh my gosh, what if yellow, that's actually green. The purpose of this? It's like a low-key backdoor anatomy teaching tool. Now we learn the colors of the human body.
Yeah, the liver is brown.
And the blood is not red, as you would think, until it comes outside the body.
Yeah.
That which you're coloring in there, which is shattered and the zombie is eating, is called a pelvis. Let's all spell pelvis.
And suddenly we're on Sesame Street.
A horrifying one. But I just want... I had a lot of gothic friends in high school.
Yeah.
People mistook me for one of them.
But well, it's a leather all black.
I had the nail polish.
Oh, yeah, that would do it too.
I had the lipstick once, but you know, like my parents were like, no, you're not doing that.
Absolutely not.
But I'm just thinking, if these coloring books had been around then, I could have handed them out. We could have just been sitting under the tree. Instead of doing dark poetry, we'd be saying like, anyone got more crimson? I'm doing a scene of a bride on the wedding night.
Yeah. You're such an edgelord.
Thank you. Okay, but then I just want to jump over because on the flip side of this, okay, no, not flip side, flip adjacent side of this.
Okay,
the neighbor of this, I guess.
Yeah, very close neighbor.
What do you get when you go into the neighbor of horror? You get vulgarity.
Yeah, vulgar humor is fun sometimes, too.
Have you ever seen any of the MacGruber's or the MacGruber movie?
No, I don't believe I have. I've not seen a lot of movies. You guys are going to yell at me in the comments, like, Whiskey's never seen this movie or Whiskey's never seen that movie.
Turn in your nerd card.
I know. My nerd card goes to other places.
Video gaming. That's equally nerdy. You can restore your nerd card if it's lost.
Yes.
You just have to do something equally as nerdy.
Yeah. And I got dungeon mastering and TTRPGs. I got the lore for days.
I used to work at a package delivery service. I was in the back of a truck with one of my coworkers, and I'm telling him, you know, I thought you were a nerd. You're not a nerd. You don't have a Hogwarts house. You don't have an anime you watch. He said, well, I play Pokemon Go. I said, okay, you're back. Welcome back. Okay, here we go.
Did he have a Hogwarts house, though?
He didn't have a Hogwarts house.
Oh.
He never chose one of those things. Oh, I'm Slytherin, by the way. Yay, evil.
I'm probably Gryffindor or maybe like a Hufflepuff.
You are definitely a Hufflepuff. You're just, whenever you go, you make people smile and make people happy. So, like, just by your presence alone, that says you are a Hufflepuff.
Oh, all right then.
And for those of you who have no idea what we're talking about, I'm not going to explain it, so I'm moving on. Okay, as I said, there is a line of adult coloring books that are described as vulgar coloring books. They contain swears, curses, all sorts of lewd imagery, I'll say.
Mm. Yeah, you were showing me a few of these in the little break, and
I want to read some of these, and I'm holding one right here. See, one of my best friends in the world, I want to give a shout-out to Kirk, who is battling cancer.
We're rooting for you, buddy. You can do it.
Screw cancer, man. We are all with you. And, you know, to help him fight cancer, we gave him some thoughtful gifts, and one of them was a book, a coloring book, which there's going to be a lot of swearing, but I'm not going to swear because there's just too much swearing. So
We're going to censor ourselves.
A little bit. The title, I'm holding it right here. The title of this book, Memos to Blanky People, a delightful and vulgar
Sucky
adult
people.
Coloring book.
Sucky people.
there's an actual disclaimer in here. Dear reader, have you ever had the experience of dealing with a blanky, incompetent person in your life? Did you ever have to restrain yourself from telling them with a few choice words? Restrain yourself no more. Instead, color the words you can't say with over 30 useful vulgar phrases meant specifically for blank holes. Memos to Blanky People provides you with an outlet where you can color your anger away. As you shade in the filthy words and innocent animals, look out for the camouflage critters. They're very good at hiding amongst the leaves and flowers in the designs. Enjoy the book, James.
Thank you, James.
Thank you, James. Now, this book, I'm going to open to a random page and just be horrified.
Okay, random page, go.
There is a meadow of flowers. They're all intertangled. There's leaves and there's little sunflowers there. And there's a badger. He's smiling as he's eating an acorn.
Oh, I thought that was a cow.
No, that's a badger. He's
definitely a badger.
And there's a beaver, or maybe that's a platypus. I think it's a beaver. He's looking very curious. And above all of this are the words, well, aren't you just the sweetest little blank cake? Except it doesn't say blank. Every page is full of forest animals and puppies and kittens and flowers. And there was a bunny. There's a bunny. Oh, this one says, will you please shut the hell up? From what I've seen in this book, that's probably the nicest one.
That's probably the tamest one we've seen. And there have been some real pieces of work.
Blank the blank up blank bag. There's puppies and a hedgehog here. I really want to color this one. I borrowed it from Kirk, but I kind of want to color this one. But this is not the worst one. This book by James Alexander is not the worst one. I happen to say, oh my gosh, I bet that there's none other like that one. And the internet said, ha!
Yeah, I mean, just in this one alone you got here in the back, he's got a internet download, ones that would have crossed the line in a printed material.
I've seen what's in this book. What crossed the line? I have to know.
I couldn't tell you. My brain simply cannot fathom the depravity of these.
I'm going to read you these names, and I'm going to once again PG censor this thing for the children.
We're not going to have any children watching this.
My nephew could listen to this. He's 3. Okay, here we go. You effing got this. Motivational swear words coloring book.
Oh my goodness, that's just great.
F off. This is my coloring book. The very effing best of John T.
Is that what Kirk told you when you asked to borrow his coloring book?
Oh, he handed the thing over. F this S. Calm the F down. Here's a good one. You are effing awesome. A motivating swear word coloring book by Charlie Bond. Mommy drinks because you cry. A sarcastic coloring book.
My goodness.
There's not even a swear word in the title, and still you just know it's inappropriate.
I love that irreverent humor.
Then you'll love this one. Daddy needs a blanking blanking beer. A sweary coloring book for Dad. Shout out to Whiskey's father, the elder nerd. One of the coolest guys I've ever met.
Maybe I'll get him that for for Father's Day. Oh,
my badass swear word coloring book for adults. Swearing coloring book for adult relaxation.
This just reminds me of those adult children's books. Like, have you seen that? And like
the Morgan Freeman ones?
No, not the Morgan Freeman ones are funny, but the Samuel L. Jackson one too.
Oh, that's what I'm talking about. Sorry, I convinced. How? Oh, whoa, they're gonna kill me for that one.
Yeah, they are.
We're going to cross the pond for a quick second because we have the British Swear Word Coloring Book, Sweary Midnight Edition, a sweary adult coloring book of 40 very English swears from the UK.
Spiffing.
Spot on. What is in that book? I want to know. But I saved the best for last. This coloring book is simply entitled Effity FFF. A swear word coloring book for adults. You get what it's promised.
I guess so. I stole that right off of South Park. I wonder how many of these come from South Park and other.
Hang on, I'm opening this book to another random page. Oh gosh, no. You blank, blankling, blanking blank. That's about as clean as I could say. I don't know what this guy is talking about, but coloring books rule! We'll be right back.
Mr. Michael T. Whiskey, you stand accused by Sergeant Pepper of the esteemed Cape Cod Police Department of driving under the influence of alcohol. Paralegals, you gotta proofread these things. Come on, you're making me look silly. Mr. Whiskey, how do you plead?
Not guilty, Your Honor.
But you admitted to Sergeant Pepper to being drunk on the scene.
That's correct, Your Honor, but I would like to put forward that while I may have been drunk, the horse was as sober as the Pope on Sunday.
You were driving a horse?
No, sir, he was taking himself home. I was just along for the ride.
On the horse?
He's a good horse, knows where he's going.
That is a good horse. Anyway, is there any case law on this? Virginia, you say? Riding lawnmowers? Well, that doesn't help this case. Florida? Oh, no, I don't even want to know.
Hi, folks.
Welcome back.
Please don't hate us.
Welcome back to the present.
Yes, this is now. Except now, that's the past, and this is now. But now, that's the past, and this is now. But this is now. But this is now. But this is now. Stop, stop.
He's getting in a loop. Bonk.
Thank you. That could have gone on for a very long time.
Yes, it could have.
Much like time, which marches on.
Bonk.
That has to stop. So what did we tell you, folks? I mean, it... We've come a long way.
We have.
We've changed a lot.
In, what, a year and a half now?
Yeah, basically a year and a half. When we started in January, the end of January was our first official episode, and now here we are sitting pretty in the smack dab middle of July.
Well, so yeah, that's a year and a half. Almost exactly.
Wow. Yeah, it is. Thank you for coming along.
Like I've mentioned before, it is appreciated.
But... once again, we rely on you people. Yes, every one of you. We rely on you people out there. Those wonderful little people out there in the dark. That's a Broadway reference. If you know it, then you're probably gay. I don't make the rules. It's just there. Or old. That also applies. So, people, like, subscribe, rate, review, share. You can find us on Audible and Stitcher. You can find us on YouTube. You can find us on... I'm floundering here. There's
Buzzsprout.
I'm trying to name all the places we are because there's so many of them.
We started on Buzzsprout.
And we ported from there.
Yeah.
And we're all over the place now. Like, everywhere, everywhere. Audible and Spotify are two of our biggest ones. We actually have, at this exact moment, 5 stars. But that's because one person liked us.
Oh, rock
on. Like, thank you to that one person. And I know one of our friends is going to be like, hey, I'm a jerk. I'm going to give them a 1-star review. And to you, if I figure out who it is, I will find you. Is that really how I want to end this?
No, let's end it more positively. Thank you so much.
I will find you. Rate, review, like, subscribe, share.
Such a dork.
Ladies and gentlemen, thank you for listening. I am your friend Frosty.
And I'm your bartender, Mike Whiskey.
It's summer out there. Go out and enjoy it. And as always,
have a cold one on us.
A dork, really?
Yes.
I'm the dork.
Yes, you are.
You know, I can see that.
You.
This podcast was recorded at and produced by Cape Media Center on Cape Cod, Massachusetts, by podcasting duo Mike Whiskey and your friend Frosty. All music and sound credits go to soundstripe.com. Special thanks to Jamie Horton, Emily Tullock, Gabrielle Rawson. For more information on Bourbon on Ice, visit our social media page at twitter.com/whiskeyfrosty. For more information on Cape Media Center, visit capemedia.org. For more listening options and a variety of podcasting entertainment, visit our hosts at buzzsprout.com and capemediacenter.org.